from its distance from the sun to how it helped change the definition of a planet and more. Join me as I show you Eris, Facts and History. Number 8. What is Eris? Depending on your familiarity with our solar system, you may or may not know about Eris, and for good reason, based on its location and how it relates to other planets and celestial objects in the system. In short, Eris is one of the largest known dwarf planets in our solar system. For those who don't know, a dwarf planet is one that has the size and shape of a planet, but fails to meet certain technical qualifications to be considered a full planet. Eris is about the same size as Pluto, but it is 3 times farther from the Sun, making it something on the very edges of our solar system. In fact, outside of some comets that have been discovered and a unique object from 2018, the two are the most distant known objects in our solar system. Eris first appeared to be larger than Pluto. This triggered a debate in the scientific community that led to the International Astronomical Union's decision in 2006 to clarify the definition of a planet. Pluto, Eris, and other similar objects are now classified as dwarf planets. Originally designated 2003 UB313, and nicknamed for the television warrior Xena by its discovery team, Eris is named for the ancient Greek goddess of discord and strife. The name fits since it remains at the center of a scientific debate about the definition of a planet. Number 7. The discovery of Eris. Given all we just told you, the discovery of this dwarf planet is really significant. Eris was discovered by the team of Mike Brown, Chan Truillo, and David Rabinowitz on January 5, 2005, from images taken in October of 2003. The discovery was announced in July of 2005, the same day as Makemake, and 2 days after Haumea, two other dwarf planets, due in part to events that would later lead to controversy about Haumea. The search team had been systematically scanning for large outer solar system bodies for several years, and had been involved in the discovery of several other large TNOs, including 50000 Quaoar, 90482 Orcus, and 90377 Sedna. The reason that Eris wasn't discovered right away via the images in 2003 was very simple. Eris was moving so slowly that scientists weren't able to detect it. The team at the Palomar Observatory had automatic image searching software that excluded all objects moving at less than 1.5 arcseconds per hour to reduce the number of false positives returned. When Sedna was discovered in 2003, it was moving at 1.75 arcseconds per hour. And in light of that, the team reanalyzed their old data with a lower limit on the angular motion, sorting through the previously excluded images by eye. In January of 2005, the reanalysis revealed Eris's slow motion against the background stars, thus leading to its true discovery. After that, the team dedicated itself to learning more about the soon-to-be-named dwarf planet, mainly learning what kind of orbit it had, and eventually learning the discovery that it had a moon within its orbit. Number 6. The Xena name. I'm sure some of you out there were a bit curious as to why a scientific team would nickname a planet Xena after the legendary TV show featuring Lucy Lawless. Granted, that's not the name the dwarf planet has now, but the story behind this nickname is honestly rather unique to our solar system. Due to the uncertainty over whether the object would be classified as a planet or a minor planet, because different nomenclature procedures apply to these different classes of objects, which would lead to the demoting of Pluto not after Eris's discovery and classification. The decision on what to name the object had to wait until after the August 24, 2006 IAU ruling. As a result, for a time the object became known to the wider public as Xena. But why that one? Xena was an informal name used internally by the discovery team. It was inspired by the title character of the television series Xena, Warrior Princess. The discovery team had reportedly saved the nickname Xena for the first body they discovered that was larger than Pluto. According to Mike Brown, who was part of the team that discovered the dwarf planet, "We chose it since it started with an X, Planet X. It sounds mythological." Okay, so it's TV mythology, but Pluto is named after a cartoon, right? And this part is actually true. we've been working to get more female deities out there. Example, Sedna. Also at the time, the TV show was still on TV, which shows you how long we've been searching. He noted that the name was honestly a bit of a joke to have fun with, because the team figured that a true name for the object would come relatively quickly, but it didn't. The process was delayed because of the classification issue, and thus Xena stuck for a long time. As for how that name got stuck with the public at large, you can blame the press for that. One reporter, Ken Chang, called me up from the New York Times, who happened to have been a friend of mine from college, and I was a little less guarded with him than I am with the normal press. He asked me, "What's the name you guys proposed?" And I said, "Well, I'm not going to tell." And he said, "Well, what do you guys call it when you're just talking amongst yourselves?" As far as I remember, this was the only time I told anybody this in the press. And then it got everywhere, which I only sort of felt bad about. I kind of like the name. While obviously Eris would take hold as the true name, the notion that Xena as the Dwarf Planet's title held on for a while is a pretty special thing, and you can bet that the show and its stars were happy to have made an impact of such a nature that they had a planet named after them. For a while, anyway. Before we continue to reveal more about Eris and its facts and history, be sure to like or dislike the video so that we can continue to improve our content for you, the viewer. Also, be sure to subscribe, that way you don't miss any of our weekly videos. Number 5. The Classification Debate. Eris is a trans-Neptunian dwarf planet, Plutoid. Its orbital characteristics more specifically categorize it as a scattered disk object, SDO, or a TNO that has been scattered from the Kuiper Belt into more distant and unusual orbits following gravitational interactions with Neptune as the solar system was forming. Although its high orbital inclination is unusual among the known SDOs, theoretical models suggest that objects that were originally near the inner edge of the Kuiper Belt were scattered into orbits with higher inclinations than objects from the outer belt. Because it was initially thought to be larger than Pluto, Pluto is a bit larger in volume, it would be later discovered. It was described as the 10th planet by NASA and in media reports of its discovery. In response to the uncertainty over its status, and because of ongoing debate over whether Pluto should be classified as a planet, the IAU delegated a group of astronomers to develop a sufficiently precise definition of the term planet to decide the issue. The irony of this is manifold, not the least of which is that for many decades, the definition of a planet was very loose, which was why Pluto was named and held as a planet for so long. There are also those who say that the new classification system isn't true, but is just an arbitrary decision made by some and not by all. This new system was announced as the IAU's definition of a planet in the solar system, adopted on August 24, 2006. At this time, both Eris and Pluto were classified as dwarf planets, a category distinct from the new definition of planet. Mike Brown, who helped discover Eris as we noted earlier, has since stated his approval of this classification. The IAU subsequently added it to its minor planet catalog. There are some who choose to ignore this classification based solely on how it's not fair to Pluto, and to those who taught astronomy and declared it as a planet. As such, some refuse to label it as a dwarf planet. It's very curious how a simple discovery can upend everything you thought you knew about something. Number 4. Orbit. Eris has an orbital period of 559 years. Its maximum possible distance from the Sun, aphelion, is 97.65 AU, and its closest perihelion is 37.91 AU. It came to perihelion between 1698 and 1699, to aphelion around 1977, and will return to perihelion around 2256 to 2258. Unlike the eight planets, whose orbits all lie roughly in the same plane as Earth's, Eris's orbit is highly inclined. It is tilted at an angle of about 44 degrees to the ecliptic. When discovered, Eris and its moon were the most distant known objects in the solar system, apart from long-period comets and space probes. It retained this distinction until the discovery of 2018 VG18 in 2018. Eris's orbit is highly eccentric and brings Eris to within 37.9 AU of the Sun, a typical perihelion for scattered objects. This is within the orbit of Pluto, but still safe from direct interaction with Neptune, approximately 37 AU. Pluto, on the other hand, like other Plutinos, follow a less inclined and less eccentric orbit, and protected by orbital resonance, can cross Neptune's orbit. In about 800 years, Eris will be closer to the Sun than Pluto for some time. Because of the high inclination of its orbit, Eris passes through only a few constellations of the traditional zodiac. It is now in the constellation Cetus. It was in Sculptor from 1876 until 1929, and Phoenix from roughly 1840 until 1875. In 2036, it will enter Pisces and stay there until 2065, when it will enter Aries. It will then move into the northern sky, entering Perseus in 2128, and Camelopardalis, where it will reach its northernmost declination in 2173. Number 3. Formation and structure. Dwarf planet Eris is a member of a group of objects that orbit in a disc-like zone beyond the orbit of Neptune called the Kuiper Belt. This distant realm is populated with thousands of miniature icy worlds, which formed early in the history of our solar system, about 4.5 billion years ago. These icy rocky bodies are called Kuiper Belt objects, trans-Neptunian objects, or Plutoids. The irony, though, is that, as we mentioned earlier, Eris is way out there in the solar system. It's one of the farthest objects from the Sun, and unlike many in the Kuiper Belt, it's not surrounded by a lot of other objects, which is part of the reason why it took so long to discover. So the question is, if it formed very much like the other objects in the belt, how was it formed so far away? We know that the Sun's gravity has an enormous range, as proven by the dwarf planet's orbit, for if it wasn't in the range of the gravity, it wouldn't be orbiting the star. But how was it able to make an object of that size that's so far away? Which brings us to the mystery of its structure. Because of its enormous distance from us, we honestly don't know much about what makes the dwarf planet tick in terms of its rock structure, its elements that make it up, etc. Now, yes, we can guess some things based on pictures. Eris most likely has a rocky surface similar to Pluto, which would add up given their distance from the Sun and the particles and elements that likely formed them. Also, scientists think surface temperatures vary from about minus 359 degrees Fahrenheit, minus 217 degrees Celsius, to minus 405 degrees Fahrenheit, minus 243 degrees Celsius, which obviously would make it a very cold and frozen world, again, just like Pluto. But the inner workings of the planet? We have little to no clue as to how that is. And unless we get a craft to where it is, that's not likely to change. Could we get something there one day? Absolutely. But the question is one of when and how long it'll take to not just get there, but get meaningful data from it. Number 2. Its moon. Eris is a very small moon called Dysnomia. Dysnomia has a nearly circular orbit lasting about 16 days. This moon is named after Eris's daughter, the demon goddess of lawlessness. A very curious pairing of names, and yet somewhat accurate given what these celestial objects have done in terms of their impact on the solar system. Dysnomia and other small moons around planets and dwarf planets allow astronomers to calculate the mass of the parent body. Dysnomia played a role in determining how comparable Pluto and Eris are to each other. Number 1. Atmosphere. The dwarf planet is often so far from the Sun that its atmosphere collapses and freezes, falling to the surface as snow. As it gets closest to the Sun in its faraway orbit, the atmosphere thaws, which is something you wouldn't expect from a planet or dwarf planet at all, further showing how location in the solar system is infinitely important. If you're curious about the magnetosphere, there is no evidence that it has one, but there also isn't any evidence that it doesn't have one. This is another case where its distance harms how much we can learn about it as a whole. Thanks for watching, everyone. What did you think of this look at Eris and everything that is associated with it in terms of fact and history? Which of these facts did you find the most fascinating? Do you think we'll ever get the chance to learn more about Eris? Let me know in the comments below. Be sure to subscribe, and I'll see you next time on the channel.